Yeah, where are the words?
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It is time to worship the Lord, and we get to hear God's word. We get to pray and talk to the living God. We get to sing praises to the Lord, our God, our Maker. And what a joyful day to do it on Spring Forward, everybody's favorite Sunday of the year. I don't know if you sprung awake this morning. You may not have. That's all right. But this is time we get to spring into worship and praise. So just want to invite us to prepare our hearts as we begin this service of worship this morning. Be ready to sing after that this morning. I want to invite us to be lifting up Kathy Sykes and Weir in prayer today. She was going to lead our worship service. She had a more important task this morning. So she has a family member who's at the hospital, and she got called in to be over there. And so she's right where she needs to be. So let us be remembering Kathy and Denise and the family that they're over giving support to this morning. Let's be remembering them today. Let's see. For things coming up this week, we have our Lent Supper and service coming up. So if you haven't gotten a chance to do an RSVP and you're planning to come, please put that in the offering plate later on. We still got plenty of room. St. Jacob's Lutheran will be having soup and sandwich supper for us. Diana Davis is going to lead us in some hymns. And Reverend Kathleen Overby Webster is going to be bringing the sermon. We've been having great nights and hope you can come out and join us for Lent Supper and service on Wednesday. What other announcements do we have this morning? Yes, Scott? What other announcements do we have this morning? All right. Well, I'd like to invite us to join together in our call to worship that is found in the bulletin. I think it's going to be up on the screen for us, too. Let's read this responsibly this morning. Rend your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord your God. For he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Amen. Let's rise and greet one another with the peace of Christ. Peace be with you.
Peace and love, ladies. Peace and love.
You to remain standing for our opening hymn. It's in the red hymnal number 432. We're going to sing Yesu, Yesu.
Give us with your love, show us how to serve, and neighbors we
Amen. You all may be seated. If children want to come forward, it's children's time. Good morning. How are you all doing this morning? All right. I got some fun stuff up here. I want to thank the Mitchells for helping me blow some balloons up this morning. Hayden and Chloe, I'm going to ask if you all would help me. I'm going to give you a balloon. And Hayden, I'm going to give you a balloon too. And I'm going to grab a balloon. All right. Let's see. Who has the smallest balloon? What do you think? Hold them up so people can see. Oh, I do. I didn't pick that very well. Let's see. Maybe I could make my balloon the biggest. And let me try something. I got something with me. It's a little thumbtack. So you might need to cover your ears a little bit. But Chloe, can I see your balloon a little bit over here? A little bit. Oh. Chloe is ready for this. Let me see. Let's see. My balloon's bigger than that one. Now, did my balloon get any bigger? No, it's still small. Maybe I didn't do it right. Hayden, can I see your balloon? You all know what to do if you need to do it. Woo. All right. Is my balloon any bigger? No. You know what? Now my friends don't have balloons. I kind of feel bad about that. Yeah, Hayden's making a good sad face for me. I think I'm going to put the pin down. And I think I'm going to do something different strategy. What about? Nick, come help. Help me share. I'm not going to be able to reach. Reach back. Help me. Oh. You know, my balloon isn't any bigger now. It's still the same size as it was. But I feel a whole lot better for sharing some balloons and seeing that you all have balloons too, and that I have a balloon too. This makes me feel a lot better than worrying about if mine's the smallest or who's the biggest. Certainly better than like popping other people's balloons. I want you to hear 1 Thessalonians 5 verses 11. So this is Paul writing to early Christians, thinking about how we're gonna live together. And this is what he writes. Therefore, encourage one another. Build each other up, as indeed you are doing. When we get to be with Jesus Christ and we get the love of God, we don't have to worry anymore about how great or big we are. God loves us, and that's enough. And we get to join in what God is doing, building other people up and sharing. And that makes me happy and smile every time. Let's see. So to go with 1 Thessalonians 5, I want you to help me. And these balloons are kind of a good upward. So I've got a little way for us to respond. And every time I lift up my balloon, I want you to help me say the word up. Okay, can you do that? So we're going to end the word with the word up. So let's just practice it one time. When I hold up my balloon, we're going to say up. Up. All right, let's try. Whenever I feel small, your love lifts me up. Whenever I feel low, your love cheers me up. Whenever I feel outnumbered, your love backs me up. Whenever I feel worn out, your love wakes me up. Whenever I feel empty, your love fills me up. Amen. Amen. Let's have a prayer. Lord, we thank you for your love and grace that builds us up. Lord, give us such faith and your love that we may build each other up in your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Kids, if you want, grab the extra balloons up here and maybe go share a balloon with somebody in the service today.
Good morning. I'm going to be reading from the book of Mark, and it's going to be the 9th chapter, and it's going to be verses 30 through 50, which is a long one, Carol, but at least I don't have any of those, like, all those tribal names and stuff in there that I can't pronounce. You'll find it on page 45 in the Pew Bible. The first part of this is Jesus again foretells his death and resurrection. They went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And in 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying, and they were afraid to ask him. The next part is, who is the greatest? Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What are you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way, they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put him among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." John said to him, "Teacher, "We saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us. But Jesus said, 'Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and to go into hell, to be unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have two feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and to be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." May God bless the reading and understanding of his word.
Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we give you thanks today for the gift of your word that you shared for us, Lord, with your disciples, with a child, Lord, with us who come to hear your word today. Open our ears to welcome you and the little ones that you've placed in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Welcoming Jesus in little ones. Jesus shared with his disciples in the midst of their fighting, striving, and arguing over which one of them is the greatest, that the way to welcome God into your life is by welcoming little ones. The sure way to reject the things of God is to reject, ignore, or exploit little ones. Jesus would reorient the disciples away from their own greatness toward the great love that God has for little ones. Have you ever noticed the love of God for little ones, last ones, least ones? It starts in the beginning, in Genesis 1. Who was first? Always, with power to be, speak, and create. Well, God was first. In Genesis 1, what was created last? Humanity, woman and man, last of all. Last is a special place to be with God. Humanity, last of all in Genesis 1 reckoning, was made in the image of God and given directions to multiply and fill the earth and have stewardship over it. Last ones filling the earth with the image of God and the ways of God. You know, God lifted up those Hebrew slaves in Egypt and delivered them from the powerful, strong, great empire of Egypt. Jesus came, and the first disciples were not great emperors or chief priests, but least sorts of folks, fishermen, tax collectors, sinners. God, throughout the scriptures, comes to serve, save, and partner with the last, least, little ones. This is what the greatness of God and God's love looks like, worked out in the world. If we are to follow Jesus for very long, we will have our lives caught up in the greatness of God, which is serving, welcoming, and valuing little ones. Kim Goddard is a United Methodist District Superintendent just next door in the Holston Conference. She loves history and tells the story of a blessing that was for those who had chosen a rabbi, a teacher. We would call those folks disciples. The blessing was, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. The blessing, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi, is a reminder that disciples did not just show up in a classroom or a synagogue to get a lesson or some information from their teacher. Disciples would follow their rabbi into the world so that all of creation and daily living was their laboratory for learning, practicing, and applying what the teacher taught. The blessing, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi, encouraged a close, intimate, daily walking with the teacher, close enough that as you trudged along the dirt roads of Galilee and Judea, that you would be close enough to the rabbi that even the dust kicked up from their sandals would fall upon you. In ancient Israel, the usual practice was for a disciple to choose their rabbi, select their teacher. Jesus didn't quite do it that way. Jesus called disciples to follow him. Jesus comes to us. God invites us. The Holy Spirit awakens us to faith. God chooses us to follow and extends the invitation to follow. And the call of discipleship is for everyone. Not all will follow. Not all who follow will follow close enough to be covered in the dust of Jesus. Are you following Jesus close enough to be covered in his dust? In Mark 9, 30 through 32, Jesus was walking dirt roads and paths through Galilee, and for a second time in the Gospel of Mark was teaching about his coming betrayal, being killed, and after 3 days that he would rise again. Jesus was teaching and preaching on the life-giving and life-raising work that he would do. The first time the disciples heard this teaching on what it meant for Jesus to be the Messiah, they opposed and rebuked Jesus' teaching. They rebuked his suffering, betrayal, and the cross. This second time, they still did not understand what Jesus was talking about, and they were afraid to ask. I wonder if they might have feared that Jesus would start talking about that taking up their cross and following him again stuff. They might have thought, maybe if we just be quiet, Jesus will stop talking about all this cross, losing our lives to gain them stuff. Have you ever had a preacher or a parent or a teacher or a boss or a spouse talking to you about something that you didn't hear about, want to hear about, or care about, or understand? And just hope if you were quiet long enough or had a blank stare long enough that they would like move on and talk about something else and get over it. It turns out you can't discourage Jesus from what Jesus is going to do. You can't outlast God. Not because God is eternal or powerful, although those are very compelling reasons, but because God is passionate about raising people from death to life, from sin to holiness, from war with themselves and neighbors to peace. God cares and loves so much is why you can't outlast or dissuade God from the laying down of God's life for little ones. It seems that the disciples of Jesus walked a little further away from Jesus the rest of the way home to Capernaum. Maybe far enough away that the dust of Jesus did not cover them. Back home, probably at Peter's house, which had become Jesus' house, didn't they go there a lot to Capernaum? How many times have you heard me say in preaching on Mark that they were back in Capernaum, back home, probably at Peter's house, which had become Jesus' home? Saying yes to being a disciple of Jesus like Peter did means Jesus gets our homes and moves in. Jesus gets our schedule, time, and direction. And as Peter followed where Jesus went, and Jesus would even call for their lives, whole lives, being given in life-giving ways to little ones. Back at home, Jesus asked the disciples what they had argued about on the way between him talking about the passion and resurrection and getting to Capernaum. For the second time in just a few verses, the disciples were silent, not in awe or contemplation. But again, Jesus had hit on something they did not want to talk about with Jesus. The things they actually cared about and thought were worth arguing about and fighting about. You know, the important stuff. Which one of them, which disciple was the greatest? Arguing about who is the greatest, doesn't that sound a bit like us? I like sports. And in American sports, you can't listen to a radio program long or a show before people start talking about quickly. Who's the greatest? The player, the team, the dynasty, the scorer, the defender. Who is the GOAT, the greatest of all time? It's not just in sports where we argue and wrestle with greatness and make lists of who's on top. Which stock, company, job, college, retirement plan, investment, real estate is the greatest? Which artist, actor, painter, songwriter, singer, dancer, playwright, sculptor is the greatest? Which song, movie, play, musical, painting, book, article? Which candidate, party, policy, president, senator, governor, leader is the greatest? And Christians and religion are not above this or beyond it either. Which church, pastor, program, theologian, pope, bishop, worship leader, Sunday school teacher, and most importantly, best potluck dish maker? That's what we really all want to know when it's time for the potluck time, right? Are they going to be there? Are they bringing that dish? Who is the greatest? Which is the greatest? Which one of us is the greatest? There are disciples of Jesus who still follow at a distance, out of what is imagined as the hearing range of Jesus. Far enough back not to be covered in Jesus' dust or life-giving, cross-carrying, serving little ones call. Where are you? Are you in dust range today? Wherever we would locate ourselves, it turns out that Jesus is very close to us. St. Augustine said, God is nearer to us than we are to ourselves. Stanley Hauerwas, the theologian and a United Methodist, he says, he repeated Augustine's saying, God is nearer to us than we are to ourselves. And that can be frightening, he would say. The disciples may have been a bit frightened or uneasy that Jesus knew just what they thought about and cared about, their own greatness. Jesus knew, no matter how far back away from Jesus' dust they trailed. If you don't already know, Jesus knows you better than you know yourself. God made you with a purpose. God knows that purpose better than you. Jesus would show us the way of the cross, humility, and serving others. And these things are not paths in and of themselves to greatness. As if I sacrifice a bit or a lot, or if I serve some little ones for a while, then I will be great and greater than other people, and I will get the benefits of my greatness. That is ridiculous. And using the good gifts and actions of God for selfish ends. Serving, loving that gives life at great cost, sharing peace, forgiving sins, are the great ways of God, of which we are invited not only to receive but share. Jesus hears what we think of greatness and turns our ideas of greatness on their heads. Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all. Here, slave of all. Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and slave of all. To give an example, Jesus took a little child, brought that child into their midst and took that child up in his arms. He said, when you welcome a little one like this child in Jesus' name, in the way that Jesus welcomes, you welcome Jesus, and not only Jesus, but you welcome the one who sent Jesus. Ancient Jews loved and cherished their children, just like many of you. In their day, children were low-status persons in the ancient world. So if there was a dirty job to be done, like washing the dust off someone's feet, it was probably a child or a slave or some other low-status person who might perform that act of hospitality, put themselves lower, literally at the feet of the person they were serving. Here, Jesus lifts up in his arms the lowest, the smallest, the littlest person there. Jesus lifts up little ones. Who would be little ones in our society today? Other people's children? Immigrants from another country? The homeless, unemployed, addicts? Who would you say is a little one? Jesus says, when you welcome little ones, you welcome Jesus. When you don't welcome little ones, keep them little, make yourself great over them. You do the same to Jesus. When Jesus picked up that little child in his arms, I wonder if he got anything on him. Did that child have sticky fingers? A toy to share and play with together? Was Jesus covered with giggles and laughter? I think if we follow Jesus close enough to lift up little ones, we will be covered in things besides dust. You know, next week will be our Rise Against Hunger meal packaging day, and each time we do it, the social hall gets covered with rice and soy, and I always feel a bit dusty afterwards. We'll vacuum and clean, but you know what? We'll find that stuff stuck in the carpet weeks from now. And every time I find a leftover grain of rice or a bit of soy, it is glorious. It reminds me of laboring together to serve little ones. It is a blessing to be covered in the dust of Jesus. John has a question about little ones as Jesus was sharing. You know, how far does this go? What about somebody who was casting out demons in Jesus' name, but he didn't follow us? So Jesus, he did something in your name, but he wasn't following us disciples. He wasn't with us. What would be the type of person we would want to stop doing things in Jesus' name because they weren't with us? What about those Roman Catholics feeding the hungry in the name of Jesus? They're not following us in Protestantism. Jesus says, man, don't stop them. Those who do good in Jesus' name are getting closer to Jesus. What about those certain Baptists who don't follow us in ordaining women in ministry, but in Jesus' name they're going to prisons to share peace and life? Jesus says, man, don't try to lock down their prison ministry. Whoever is not against us is for us. What about those folks who aren't with us anymore in the United Methodist Church after disaffiliation, and they're out reforming congregations to share Jesus with people? Jesus might say, don't you get it yet? Don't worry if they follow you. Be glad they are striving to follow me. You follow me too. When we see people welcoming little ones in Jesus' name, let us rejoice and bless them for that work they are doing with Jesus Christ. Rodrigo Cruz is another United Methodist District Superintendent. He's down in the North Georgia Conference. He helps with Fresh Expressions Movement in the United Methodist Church. They are looking for fresh ways to reach people who have felt neglected by the church, little ones. There were some folks talking about their churches being friendly and welcoming. Who here would like us to be a friendly and welcoming church? Amen? Amen. Amen. How about friendly and welcoming for little ones? Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. Amen. Rodrigo Cruz gives this helpful and challenging word to friendly and welcoming congregations. People will visit when they are welcomed, but they will stay when they are valued. People will visit when they are welcomed, they will stay when they are valued. When Jesus picked up the little child and affirmed the person who was ministering to little ones in his own name, Jesus did not only say they were welcome to hang out and come or go or whatever. Jesus said in his actions, the fullness of the kingdom of God is for them. He lifted up their faith and God's love and value for them, and the grace and importance of the work that the person casting out demons was doing in Jesus' name. Disciples of Jesus Christ, you are to be for them. Value them, build them up, serve them, bless them, treasure them, fully welcome them, value them, and welcome God's presence. Someone may say, it's hard to welcome Jesus, God the Father, and the Holy Spirit, who I can't see. Jesus has helped us. We may welcome and value little ones who we can see, and so welcome and value Jesus who we can't see. Then, after these stories, Jesus got really stern, talking hellfire and millstones fastened around necks, and not going for a swim, but for a sink. Jesus said, don't put any stumbling blocks before little ones, barriers to Jesus, things to trip them up or slow them down in getting close to God for those who believe in Jesus. You know what stumbling block Jesus probably had in mind in these passages? Was disciples fighting, wrangling, and striving for personal greatness. Disciples getting people to follow them and fit in with them rather than following Jesus and fitting in with Jesus. Or any stumbling block, misnamed greatness, set up as an idol over against the greatness of God's serving, cross-bearing, resurrection, life-raising love for little ones. Jesus talked about Gehenna. In most English Bibles, Gehenna is translated as hell. So you miss the word Gehenna that Jesus used. Gehenna is the Valley of Hinnom, which is west, southwest of Jerusalem. It was a real place. In the Old Testament, there was a place of worship there to the god of Molech. Molech's name is kind of a great kind of name. It's related to words like king, to rule, to be revered. Let me suggest that Molech's name sounded like a great one. Molech is known in the Bible as a god that people would offer children to in sacrifice and burning. Later, Israel destroyed that place of worship to Molech. They turned it into a trash dump where garbage was burned and where worms went through what was left over. It was a way to illustrate what they thought of the god of Molech, who called for the killing and sacrificing of little ones so people could gain Molech's favor. That kind of thinking and worship was garbage. In Jesus' day, Gehenna was still a trash dump for Jerusalem, where garbage was burned. This is quite an image that Jesus gives. Especially when I think of what Kim Goddard started us thinking about with that blessing of being covered in the dust of your rabbi. Would we sacrifice little ones and be covered in their ashes and dust? Or serve and give our lives for little ones and be covered in the dust of Jesus? Jesus uses the extreme language here of cutting off a hand or a foot or cutting out an eye. Jesus uses these unforgettable images to say it would be better to have our own personal greatness maimed by entering the service of God and neighbor, and in so doing, knowing the greatness of life with God, much better that than to retain our own personal greatness and end up in the unquenchable fire of trash dump Gehenna. The trash dump fires of Gehenna and the place of crucifixion and the empty tomb were not that far away from each other in Jerusalem. But the lives to live in welcoming little ones or rejecting them are quite different and lead to quite different places. There is no greatness in sacrificing little ones for personal greatness, national greatness, safety, prosperity, or to escape pain or discomfort. We need to repent of devaluing little ones and leave that behind in Gehenna burning trash dump where it belongs. May you be covered in the dust of Jesus as you welcome and value the little, last, and least. May your eyes of faith be open to see how you are welcoming God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We are going to sing, and we're going to sing about God's love for little ones like us. Jesus Loves Me. It's in your hymnals on page 191. Let's stand and sing together. It's time for our time of prayer together. I'd like to lead us in a prayer, and we'll have a time to lift up our joys and concerns silently or out loud in our prayers of intercession and seeking God's grace as well. We'll close together with the Lord's Prayer. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Lord, we give you thanks. For though there are times we have been last and little and least, and all of us, Lord, like children, Lord, your love comes to those just like us. And Lord, in your mercy, you give us this world. You give us your word. You give us the prophets and scriptures and the church. You give us Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit. You hold nothing back, Lord, to show your great love and deliverance. Lord, we praise you and thank you for it. Lord, we take time this morning, Lord, and we lift up our praises and thanksgiving today. Lord, we give you thanks for family and for home, and that our homes may welcome you, Lord, and have the love of God in them to share. Lord, we thank you for the church and for our leaders and all people who are coming to worship Jesus. Fill us again and today, Lord, with your love and with your passion, Lord, that we would live in your purposes and grace. Lord, we give you thanks for neighbors and for our homeland and for the different countries of this earth, Lord. You have filled this earth with beauty as we look around and see the first flowers and bulbs of spring beginning to come up. Lord, continue to bless our farmers and our leaders in our homes, Lord, and our communities, Lord. Help us to know your ways of peace and building each other up. Lord, we give you thanks, Lord, for the gift of food, for our talents, for jobs, for education, Lord, for all the resources you give us. Lord, give us your grace not to be selfish or to hoard these things, Lord, but to share them for the building up of our brothers and sisters in Christ and our neighbors in the world. Lord, we just take this time to lift up our praise and our thanksgivings to you, Lord, out loud and in our hearts. Lord, we also lift up our needs, Lord, in the places where we see your grace is still needed in our lives, in our world today. Lord, there are many places broken by war and unrest, Lord, with Russia and Ukraine, with Israel and Hamas and the people of Gaza. Lord, in many places in Africa where there's unrest, in Haiti, Lord, where gangs are just about taking over the country, Lord. Lord, we pray and we ask, Lord, that you would help us to know your ways of peace, Lord. Lord, we pray today for those who are sick. Lord, we give you thanks for Kathy and Denise going to family today, going to share their presence and the love and grace of Christ. Just be with them, Lord, as they go. Lord, we pray your grace and sustaining mercy and healing for those who are sick, and help us, Lord, to lift up those who are ill at this time. Lord, we pray for those who are dying. Lord, we pray that you come alongside them with your hope and your comfort and give them your good news and hope that we have in your love and grace with us. Lord, we pray today for the poor, for the hungry, for those who can't find work or good work, for those who work and live in unsafe conditions. Lord, for those who are displaced by war, for refugees, Lord, there are many in need of your care and our care. Lord, we pray you continue to lift up little ones and help us to do the same. Lord, we lift up all of our needs this morning silently and out loud for your mercy and grace. Lord, we thank you that you hear our prayers, our silent prayers and our out loud prayers that we can pray together. Lord, come in your mercy and bring us your hope and your peace and salvation. Lord, we pray that you help us as disciples of Jesus Christ to be close enough to you, Lord, to get your dust on us, Lord. Lord, we pray for those who aren't disciples of Jesus Christ yet, Lord. Help them to hear your call and see your grace, even and especially, Lord, in your love lived in faith in our lives, Lord. We pray that you would help us to do it. And let us pray together as Christ taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. I want to invite our ushers to come forward this morning. Today we are taking our third and final Rise Against Hunger offering. Next week, we're going to invite you to come back and bring a sack lunch. And after worship at 12:30, we're going to start packing about 10,000 meals. We've got some friends from other churches and neighbors and groups coming with us, but we're going to need your help. Bring a friend. We can knock it out in about 2 hours. The first set of plates, we're going to send the wood plates around. That's for the Rise Against Hunger offering. We are at 3,290 dollars. Our goal is to get to $4,100. In faith, I say we can do it. Yes. I want to give thanks. A couple months ago, our United Women in Faith got together, and they said we're going to give $200 to Rise Against Hunger. And then after that, the United Methodist Men met, and they had heard about this, and they said we're going to give $250. And then the United Women in Faith heard about this. They said, they're crazy if they think they're going to beat us. So they met last week and they said, we're going to give another $200. Praise God, we are getting so close to that $4,100 goal. Bless you all as you give. So the first set of plates to go around, Rise Against Hunger. We're going to send around the brass plates too. That will be for our regular tithes and our offerings. Let's worship God this morning with our giving. If you're giving at home, you can always send in funds or give on Tithely today. Let's worship God with our giving. Amen. Lord, we give you thanks today. Bless these gifts for Rise Against Hunger and all who will be coming to share in that work of packing meals next week. Lord, bless these tithes and offerings for lifting up little ones in our church, in our neighborhood, in the world today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is in the red hymnal, number 380, There's Within My Heart a Melody. Praise God. Let's make a little more music together.
Yeah.
To praise the Lord.
Amen. And whoever set up the altar, too, that's really beautiful with the amazing grace. Whoever did that, that's beautiful.
Amen. This blessing today as we go. May you be covered in the dust of Jesus and covered in all the grace that comes in walking and picking up little ones. Amen.
Amen.
Good job, girl.
Oh, thank you.